Okay, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Glad to see a lot of you made it here for 8 o'clock in the morning. I know it's a tough start on the second day of RSA. I see you've got breakfast, a lot of you. That's great. You get to eat while I talk. It's another benefit, the joys of being a speaker, right? My name's Derek Manky. I'm with Fortinet, representing the office of the CISO, Global Security Strategist. I've been with Fortinet for 14 years now. Quick background, came from a background of reverse engineering and threat analysis. And now I'm working on a lot of cutting edge trends, working in industry. And today I'm gonna be talking on the concept of swarm. So if you look at the title, order versus mad science, order of course being the white hat side of the equation, mad science being the black hat. And we're gonna be focusing on the black hat side, what's happening with attackers, how are they evolving? Not just numbers are going up and attacks are getting worse, but really what's happening in terms of technology and black hat code. And then we're gonna kind of position that in terms of how we're gonna, how we should be prepared moving forward to defend against that. Okay, so this isn't Matthew Broderick here. Let's play a game. That game's already been played, right? We're in a vast, completely different world. Now, I've been with Fortinet for 14 years. I've been in cybersecurity for 20 years. I'm not this old. Okay, but 1971, this is the world's first computer virus and creeper virus, right? It's very simple. Obviously back then, this was just a proof of concept code to spread through the 10X operating system. Very simple, right? As we all know, today, that whole landscape has completely changed, right? This was 10 years ago even, right? We started with just some proof of concept codes and worms. Now, when we talk about cyber crime, we're in a full-blown infrastructure. Right? You have about 10 years ago, the rise of fake antivirus software, affiliate programs, distributors in the middle, right? Running the game, infecting systems, getting commission cuts for infecting systems, money mules and laundering networks, cyber criminal organizations building infrastructure, renting that infrastructure, people coming to people for consultation. But what's the common equation here? Just think about that for a second. If we look at cybercrime, the common equation 10 years ago, even 15 years ago, there's a lot of people. There's a lot of people here, right? And that's one of the themes I wanna talk to about today, is that people, i.e. the black hat attacker, is being taken further and further out of the equations as attacks accelerate. And that's what I'm gonna start talking about as we analyze and start looking at what's happening in terms of speed, agility, automation, and swarm activity, okay? So speed kills. Right, especially if it's done in a negative context, right? When we talk about swarm botnets, one of the key aspects is the concept of it, accelerating the attack chain, okay? So I'm gonna get to explain a bit what's happening with that. When we talk about swarms, okay, we see this, I mean, this has been around in nature forever. We look at ants as an example, flocks of birds. What's the common goal, right? It's an intent-based goal. It's about strength in numbers on the black hat side, is how different individual nodes or units of a swarm act towards a common goal. Together, they're stronger, right? In this case, you can see ants crossing a gap in a leaf, right? They're constructively working together towards a common goal. So it's an intent-based solution. Right? If you look at attacks that are happening on the black hat side, again, going back to that other slide, a lot of these attacks are instruction-based. They're task-oriented, right? You have botnets and command and control herders that will infect systems. They'll go through different stages of the attack chain and tell them task by task what to do. In a swarm, this doesn't happen. You have different peers. There's no central commander, right? You have different peers that are talking to each other, instructing each other, hey, lend me a helping hand. I need help with this in order to be able to cross this bridge, because that's the common goal, to cross a bridge, right? So this is positive construction. Of course, swarm can also work in terms of negative too, right? If we look at swarm behavior with humans, right, in terms of riots, stock trading on instinct, right? This is an infectious behavior that can happen that's starting to spread from different peers, right? Peer to peer. I was walking to the Moscone Center this morning, and I'm sure we see this in our everyday lives. I was just thinking about this morning, right? Crossing the crosswalk, you have that big do not cross sign flashing at you in red. One person starts crossing, two people start crossing, all of a sudden five people start crossing, because there's more confidence, there's more of a swarm mentality that starts happening. It's that strength in numbers. Hey, if there's five or six people crossing, chances are this is going to be easier to cross the street. Again, that's what happens in these spur-of-the-moment kind of behaviors with swarm activity in humans. So I do a lot of looking on the threat landscape, right, again, for about 20 years now. So I don't want to give a whole history lesson of what has happened in the past. That's not what I'm here for. I want to talk about what's happening now and where we're going in the future, right? So every year, me and FortiGuard Labs, we look at what's happening in terms of trends and where are we heading, right? And our lead prediction this year was that we're going to start to see the rise of self-learning swarm bots and hive networks. It sounds kind of fancy, but in essence, you know, the idea here is exactly what I was talking about. We're going to start to see code that is starting to take a life of its own on, right? That's starting to take away the human out of the loop in terms of the black hat attacker and make decisions on its own, right? That's a key point, being able to make decisions on its own based on intelligence that's spread throughout the botnet network. So how does that happen exactly? So again, if we talk about the concept of the attack chain, you know, I call this the attack chain. Of course, many of you might be familiar with the Lockheed Martin cyber kill chain. So the cyber kill chain, of course, says that at any given attack, there's multiple components. It's not just wave a magic wand or press a button and an attack happens, right? So the idea of the accelerated attack chain is that in any sort of, if you're thinking of a black hat attacker, in any sort of attack, you have to go through multiple stages. You gotta go through reconnaissance and planning. This can take quite a bit of time, right? Breaking in, of course, so exploitation into systems. Once you're into a system and you have a foothold, lateral movement, moving throughout that system to be able to gain access to other critical components. You might be after credit card information, social insurance, maybe intellectual property, right? So that's the goal, but you have to go through multiple components of this attack chain, gathering that information once you're in there. Then once you have the information, that's not the end game, right? You still got to exfiltrate that information and get it out of the system. So going back to that slide I talked about before, this, you know, when you look at cyber criminal organizations, we study these a lot. In fact, in some cases that we work on, like business email compromise scams, some of these organizations are over 40 people strong in just one organization, right? Now, you know, keep in mind they're making over $60 million in about 2 or 3 months. So there's a big ROI in terms of the humans there. But if we talk about scaling and the way they're trying to capitalize, especially on the world of IoT today, this is what's happening. They're trying to accelerate the attack chain, right? Of course, the deeper you go down in the attack chain, the more risk there is to the business, right? Because you're getting closer to that end game. And at the same time, as the attack chain is accelerated, what I call the TTB, the time to breach, is decreasing. This used to be months, right? If it's all humans working on this, it used to be months in order to launch a successful attack, get information. Now with common tools, technology, and what I'm going to show you with automation and swarm, that time to breach is drastically reducing. We're talking about minutes to seconds in the future. Of course, thinking of a stock trading and latency in terms of milliseconds, right? One example of automation, so this isn't swarm per se, but it's an important building block, is autosploit. So this is a relatively new framework that's been released using public technology, okay? So it uses Shodan. A lot of you have probably heard of Shodan, which is a search engine available on the internet, right? It's a giant database that fingerprints all devices out there, what daemons and services are they running. So it's a good blueprint of the internet, if you will. So what the creator of this framework has done has stitched two common, easy to access, solutions together, one being Shodan, the other being Metasploit, right? If you just think about it, those are two very powerful tools. You have a giant database of potentially vulnerable victims, and then you have a framework that can exploit and try to attack those victims once you've indexed it. So literally what this framework does is just stitch together these two solutions in order to accelerate that attack chain, right? It becomes actually quite easy. So in terms of anyone who doesn't even have, this is another thing, the skill set in order to launch these attacks is also getting less and less and less. You have to be, before you'd have to actually write these tools and be quite adept. Nowadays, it's literally, I'm gonna show you a little demonstration video. literally just typing in several commands, and off you go, you have a very powerful weapon. If you're using this in terms of a black hat attack. I want to always point that out, of course. A lot of these tools are created for white hat penetration testing and security awareness, too. So in this case, what I'm going to show you in the video is that you have the Autosploit interface. We have a Kali Linux setup, right? So you go into the Linux box, set up Autosploit. You'll type in an API key for Shodan. Once you have that, Autosploit itself will connect with that API key up to Shodan. The query result comes back very quickly. And all of a sudden, the framework has a list of a potential attack targets that you want to go after. And as an attacker, you can type in whatever attack target you want. Is it IIS? Is it Apache Struts? So forth, right? You can kind of pick your poison. And the key part about Autosploit is that it's intelligent enough to actually do matching. So once it knows the targets that you're after, it's actually going to connect up to Metasploit and index targets. So you're not just, you know, firing rapid fire, creating a whole bunch of noise. It's intelligently selecting exploits that are going to work, most likely work, on those targets. It's going to launch and run that. And of course, at this point in time, we're talking about mass exploitation, and we're talking about a lot of boxes being owned. And that's the first step to creating a massive IoT network that you can use to build swarm technology, which is exactly what we're seeing out there, and I'll talk about that. So some problems with this, of course, is that it's very easy to launch. No real skills are needed. It uses a lot of dangerous exploits that can crash, destroy systems as well. Even in the hands of someone intending not to do anything too malicious, like, again, pressing a couple buttons and launching an exploit command, there could be a lot of damage done. Okay, so with that, I'm going to get into a video, and I'll talk you through it. This is just a quick demonstration that we created in our labs to explain what's happening here. So in this case, again, like I said, we have a Kali Linux setup, okay? So by going into the Autosploit framework, you get a nice ASCII interface in Python. This will pull up the Autosploit interface, okay? What you're going to see here is just several commands for configuring. On the first command, this is on initial setup, so of course subsequent launches are going to be quite a bit quicker. On the initial setup, all you have to do using your Shodan account is get the API key, take that key, copy it. Everybody knows that subsequently put it into the Autosploit framework. Everybody knows that the captain. Once you put it into the Autosploit framework, by the way, this is I'm talking about Shodan in this example. You can also use Census and some other, you know, they continue to add more functionality to this. So this is what I mean here. You can pick your poison. Apache Struts in this example is what we're after. So we're just looking specifically at blueprinted services out there running Apache Struts. So what this does is already, just with that command, it's already downloaded that whole index file, just like that, okay? So that's what I mean by that accelerated attack chain. Before, that would have to be something that would be done incredibly quickly. That would take quite a bit of time, right? But now this is done incredibly quickly. We're taking a little bit more time in the demo to kind of just show you what's happening on the back end, but keep in mind, you could do this literally in probably 10 seconds once you have it set up properly. So, once you have that index, right, so this is the first piece, index potential, potential vulnerable services and victims that you have out there. The second piece then is to look at those victims and if you want to match up the potential exploits and then to launch that exploit too. So I'm just showing you the initial setup here because this is, you know, there are some additional commands, but we're talking about probably in the order of 10 commands in total to use. And then once you have those commands, all you have to do is launch the exploit module, which you'll see in this picture. Of course, we didn't actually exploit these. The video carries on to show, of course, once you have an exploited victim, what you can do. It's game over at that point, right? Because what a lot of people would use something like this for is for launching Trojans, doing data exfiltration, stealing cookies on Facebook and social media and so forth, right? Crypto jacking, there you go. Absolutely, yeah. That's big money nowadays, right? that's really changed too since, you know, from fake antivirus, ransomware, cryptojacking is a big thing, especially with IoT botnets. So, you know, my point is with Autosplay, now we have this automation framework that exists out there. On top of that, where are we headed in terms of swarm, right? That's what I wanted to talk about today. If we look at traditional botnets, going back even 20 years, of course, a botnet is, you know, you have the botnet herder, an attacker, you have the zombies, right, which are your infected nodes in a network. This has evolved over 20 years from centralized IRC chat to, you know, botnets like Conficker and all of the botnets in the past over the last 10 years. This is a very common model, right? But again, what do you have here? You have the attacker issuing the commands. It's very task-oriented. Attacker walking through each step of that attack kill chain, right? But what if you took that attacker out of the loop? This is what I call the next-gen botnet 3.0 swarm, right? What if you had intelligent nodes with the inside of a botnet that are actually able to communicate with each other, share information, and then act on a common goal, right? Now keep in mind, this may be initiated, of course, the botnet may be built and initiated by the black hat attacker, but the idea here is that this is largely accelerated through the swarm mentality. We've seen precursors of this, okay? And this is why, you know, based on educated guesses and trends that we see in our labs, you know, Satori is a good example. It shares intelligence in its nodes. It will refuse to attack a target if it finds that better targets are found, right? Or if a camera is hacked, that it's trying to hack is under stress. This is shared intelligence within the nodes, so it's similar to pheromones that are shared in nature, right? Between animals and insects. Frankenstein malware, this is an older one now. This is about 4 years old, but it's another example of a swarm. This was on a code-based level, so we're not talking about a network swarm. This was malware that would actually stitch together code, so running blocks and different processes using Lua interpreter, and put that into a running process. A lot of this, of course, is for malware antivirus evasion. We've seen downloaders, I think a BitTorrent. BitTorrent actually calls itself a swarm, too, because if you think of what BitTorrent is doing, it's getting different bits of information from files, but it's a common goal again. Let's assemble a file on one system. Malware can use the same concept, blockchain, right? We're going to see more examples of this in terms of communication through blockchain for attackers as well. One of the most interesting ones 2 years ago, so we first saw this in our labs in 2016, was an IoT botnet called Hajime. Okay, this was the first decentralized, meaning peer-to-peer, right? So taking that attacker out of the loop, IoT botnet that we saw. This one supports, it's quite interesting because it supports 9 different platforms, including x86. So we're not even just talking about IoT, we're also talking about PCs and x86. So cross-platform functionality. We're seeing over 30,000 detections a day in FortiGuard with this botnet. So it hasn't gone away. The way that it functions is quite interesting. I'll show you a little animation here. So it's the first, as I said, the first decentralized IoT botnet that we've seen out there. And I'm going to show you the second one coming up. It runs BusyBox. It supports different platforms, like I said. The idea of it is that it's going to try to brute force its way via Telnet and SSH into different systems. Once it's identified the target architecture, it'll go onto that system. It will download payload, report that back to a report server. This is very similar to the way that Mirai, which is another large IoT botnet that we've seen, functions, right? But in this case, of course, one of the main differences with Hajime is that it's operating in a peer-to-peer functionality, right? So this is something out there that we've seen a lot of activity on. It hasn't been, you know, a disastrous effect in terms of popping up on the radar or any, you know, large-scale breaches happening with it. But this one is the most interesting one that has actually happened after this prediction we made on swarm networks, okay? So this is the hide and seed botnet. This was first discovered in January of this year, so we're just talking about a couple months ago. And it's the second known decentralized peer-to-peer botnet that we've seen out there. It uses exploits to spread to Netgear TP-Link routers as well. We actually just released a blog on this. If you haven't read it, I suggest you read it. It's a really good comparison of hide and seek versus Mirai. In fact, hide and seek borrowed a lot of code from the Mirai botnet. Going back to that first slide, I talked about crime services and crimeware. That's very common. We see that a lot today. A lot of these kits that are released, modifications, hey, this works really good. I'm going to keep that, but I'm going to modify this to do something else I want to achieve. That's exactly what the authors of hide and seek have done. So they've modified Mirai. They actually created, and this is the most interesting part, they've created a custom peer-to-peer protocol on hide and seek. So there's various commands in here, right? Some interesting commands are the ability to identify a new vulnerable host within the network itself. So this comes down to that swarm mentality, because we literally have nodes within the network that are capable of discovering. Because if you look at Mirai, it's actually randomly just trying to find victims, so it's a blind fire, right? In this case, what it's doing is if a node in the network finds a victim, it will actually notify all the other nodes in the network of that victim. So that's that shared intelligence starting to happen in the swarm. The other really interesting thing about hide and seek is that it's capable of not just doing like a DDoS attack like other networks typically do, of actually downloading files as well, right? So we're talking about espionage, reconnaissance, and so forth. I'm going to walk you through a quick animation on here in a second. These are some screenshots from some of the analysis we did on hide and seek. It's pretty intelligent. It's able to add firewall rules to allow traffic through. As I said in figure two here, you see it scanning for victims. Figure three, this one's quite interesting. This is a Wireshark capture we did. Peer-to-peer communication traffic, retrieving ELF files, so binaries through the stream. This is an actual command, right? So another command that a peer can issue to another peer is give me a file on your device. That's quite fascinating to me because, again, this comes really down to that swarm aspect where you have not an attacker, but you have one peer talking to another peer and then receiving information on behalf of that other peer, right? Now, I'm not saying this is Skynet, not yet, right? But we're seeing a lot of indications of that swarm with this sort of technology. So in this case, how would you build something like this, right? Number one, using a tool, as I said, seeding the swarm like Autosploit. You talked about cryptojacking earlier. Build yourself a big IoT botnet. From there, if hide and seek is planted, you can see this security camera in the middle is previously unidentified. What's illustrated here is that one of the swarm nodes of hide and seek has actually found, using that exploit, a vulnerable host within that network. It spreads that information around to all the other nodes in the swarm. And then the swarms are aware of that network. They can, of that new victim. They can communicate with that new victim, and they can receive files on behalf of that victim. So now you have a case where, in the worst case scenario for a business or an organization, you have, say, intellectual property. And this is a case of an IP security camera, but just think towards the future, things like Hajime that have x86 and PC-based technology. You have the capability of your crown jewels, digital assets, intellectual property sitting on one device that's now been spread to 5 or 6 or 10 different compromised devices in the network. Think about that attack chain, that exfiltration piece, right? How do you get that data out of the network? This is a very good, solid plan way to get that data out of the network, right? That's another, characteristic or feature of these swarm networks in terms of robust technology and being able to, does that strength in numbers seem from the swarm aspect again? Okay, so again, those are precursors of what we're seeing. I think hide and seek is the best example. It's very fresh, it's very interesting. I wanted to, as I said earlier in my talk, position of what we need to do as white hats to be able to defend against these. So if you think of swarms, of course, another concept that comes up in terminology, and this is just an analogy, are hive networks, right? So as opposed to a swarm, which is just a whole bunch of nodes acting together, a hive is about group survival, right? You can kind of think of it as of the mothership, right? So this is exhibited a lot of the times in nature, again, through elephants, meerkats, even humans acting as a corporation. If you think of humans as the swarm aspect, the corporation is the hive. Let's all work together to defend that corporation, right? common goals, making sure that your stock price is up, things like this, right? That's how all the nodes will work together to actually protect and work towards that intent base with the hive. Bees, as another example, right? Together as a group, the intelligence rises, but if you think of an actual beehive, right, you have the queen inside of the hive, the different workers within the hive have to go and gather food and bring it back to that hive. So the hive is the structure, it's the group. And of course, I'm talking about bees and insects, but in terms of cybersecurity, it's really no different, right? So you might think of a cloud. Some people might think, okay, well, cloud, everything's in the cloud, and this might be the hive. And, you know, it's actually just a part of the hive. When I think about hive in terms of cybersecurity and the fabric, it's end-to-end security. You're talking about endpoints, you're talking about private cloud, hybrid cloud, all the way up to public cloud as well. If your organization has endpoints, and it probably does, and your organization has a data center, or servers, or services running in the cloud, that's part of your hive, right? So what do you do to defend that? So a hive defense strategy, if we look here, you have these threats, as I talked about, Autosploit, Shodan, using Shodan and Metasploit. You have all these mounting IoT-based threats, and hide and seek, as I said, is a good example of that. These are intent-based attacks that are starting to come at us. So the only solution to this, the best solution, is an intent-based defense. So this is hive-based defense. It's a fabric of all of these different devices tied together, working in unison. So just like an attacker is starting to be taken out of the loop when it comes to these attacks, we need to start taking our network, so our NOC and our SOC, our network administrators, further out of the loop. I'm not saying get rid of them, but we need to start thinking about repurposing them to be able to properly defend with this. So in a hive defense, of course, some key characteristics are devices that are working together in unison, integrated together, sharing intelligence. So we're talking about network defense, right? Everything from sandbox to endpoint to gateway, mail, and things like this that can actually share information and then act on that information. We're talking about setting up security policies, mitigation. Detection is part of that, but mostly mitigation. This is a very key thing that needs to happen. Of course, if you just have a whole bunch of endpoint solutions that are sitting there and not talking to, point solutions that are sitting there and not talking to each other, that's certainly not a hive defense and certainly not going to be able to cut it. It's literally an arms race, right? If you think about that time to breach and that attack chain, if automated technology on the Black Hat side is reaching the end game that much quicker than you can defend against, it's game over at that point. So it's very important to be able to have an agile defense system. One example of what we're doing in the industry with this, so Fortinet, we're a founding member of the Cyber Threat Alliance. I actually represent the steering committee there. This is a great use case of a swarm, what we're doing on the white hat side in the industry. So you have different leading security vendors in the space that are actually working together, right? So if one vendor discovers a threat, just like I was talking about that swarm mentality on sharing actionable information, that information can be shared throughout the Cyber Threat Alliance and integrated into each other's hive. Again, I'm just keeping that thought process mentality in your mind, right? We call it a fabric at Fortinet. But the idea here is that we have different nodes. You can think of each vendor as a node sitting out there in cyberspace. And as a node discovers an attack, indicators of compromise from that attack can be shared throughout that whole swarm. And then defense properties can be put in place. That's exactly what we're doing. You know, as we receive information, we'll actually actively add defense end-to-end into our hive or fabric. So it's a good example of what we're doing out there in the industry. When we think about advanced solutions for swarms, expert systems. So an expert system is basically, you hear a lot here, of course, about artificial intelligence. You're going to continue to hear about that for years. Everybody talks about it. I'm not here to give an AI talk. I'd love to. I could talk 2 hours about that. But I'm just going to talk very quickly. The idea of artificial intelligence is you should think, is your AI solution artificial intelligence or is it actionable intelligence? It should be the latter. It should be actionable intelligence. Because that's what an AI system does, or an expert system, is it's able to take intelligence and then actually act on it, right? So that comes down to a good, you know, idea, a good example of what you should be looking for in terms of something like anti-malware. Do you have an AI system or an actionable intelligence system that can actually proactively fix the patient zero problem, right? Brand new zero-day code. We're starting to see, going back to that Frankenstein malware I talked about, that's a good example of code that's constantly changing, constantly trying to evade security technology. So AI solutions for anti-malware, a system that can actually take in a raw sample, use an artificial neural network to be able to scan, weight features, determine if that file is malicious or clean. This is a good solution out there. It's just one solution to the swarm. This is on an anti-malware level, but it is a good solution. But again, you have to think of how you can start integrating the artificial intelligence solutions into different use cases like this, right? And when you look at an AI solution as well, AI learns over time. It's just like humans, right? So look for something that's been around for a while that's not just set up last night as a one-stop shop overnight. Right? So again, I don't want to go down the whole AI path because it's going to take up a lot of time, but it's definitely something you should start thinking about when it comes to swarm defense. Again, yesterday's primary strategy was static boundary security, right? When we think about edge security, that's not going to cut it anymore. It hasn't for years, especially when we talk about swarm. So a new concept you should be looking at is agile macro and micro segmentation. So I talked about that, you know, the hive defense and that ability to actually dynamically being able to understand threats. Because we think about IoT botnets, these IoT devices oftentimes are roaming in and out of our networks, right? So you need a security solution that's able to accomplish this. Agile macro micro segmentation, meaning that once the security solution actually detects a threat, like an IoT device roaming onto a network, it's able to actively lock down, quarantine, if you will, that threat on the system. Segmentation is a very, very key part of hive and swarm defense as well. Because it's so dynamic, right? You look at these devices that are roaming, code that's roaming, you look at these swarm networks, the swarms are moving quite fast, laterally in and out of networks. So you literally need a system that can shut it down. Defense in depth, of course. So we look at going back to that attack chain. Now this is the kill chain aspect. Right, so attack is as an attacker going through. If we're thinking of the defense side on the kill chain, you have, again, the reconnaissance, delivery, exploitation, command and control, all the aspects I talked about earlier. In traditional solutions, a lot of people will stack up, defense solutions against an invisible enemy. Yeah, I'm going to buy a firewall. I'm going to try to maybe buy a sandbox or something like that. But the key point is a lot of the times this technology, again, is not integrated. So if you look at things like next generation firewall, it's going to cover aspects like exploitation, payload delivery, so anti-malware, command and control. You have other devices with, you can think of this as your fabric or hive again within there. But again, ask the question, is it truly your hive? Is it integrated together? Right? This is a very important concept that you have to start thinking about, because if one device down the kill chain, like a sandbox, detects a threat, it should be able to communicate with your internal segmentation firewall, something further down the kill chain, so it can block that threat before the threat gets to it, right? That sharing of intelligence is very key when it comes to kill chain defense. Okay, so I know we're getting low on time. I just wanted to give you a couple of takeaways from this, just to kind of reiterate it in your mind. So next week, following this, you should think about your hive. So where is it located, right? Is it distributed? Is it centralized? Is it just in the cloud? Are you talking about endpoints, right? So just a simple thought, thinking about your fabric and your hive, where that is. Secondly, moving forward in the next 3 months, look at your critical assets, right? So what resources do you have in that hive? Think about that, going back to that beehive. What are the key resources there? It's the queen. It's the food coming into the hive. So on your network, data is the new currency. It could be data in your network, right? Most likely is. Where is that data located within your network? How do you identify those critical assets, right? So that should be a 3-year plan. That's a tough thing, by the way, identifying a lot of these critical assets, because they're constantly moving, especially when we talk about distributed networks and so forth too. Within 6 months, an orchestrated security model. So once you've defined what your hive and your footprint is, identify the critical assets in there, and then in 6 months, start creating an orchestrated. And when I say orchestrated, I'm not just talking about SD-WAN or SDN and so forth. I mean, that's one technology. But look at technology solutions out there that are actually orchestrated together, sharing that intelligence, right? That creates a security fabric, okay? So integrated intelligence sharing in that. Look at AI solutions like I talked about. It's an aspect of that versus zero-day code. Also, if you're using different vendors within your network, ask, are they sharing information, right? Look to see if they're a member, as an example, of the Cyber Threat Alliance, right? Because that's another benefit to that hive or that swarm shared intelligence, like I said. And finally, a big theme you'll see here at RSA is NOC SOC integration. So taking network solutions and security solutions, marrying them together. How do you integrate? That's all about that, making that kill chain defense all the more smoother. Repurposing, I didn't say replace, but repurposing human talent. There's a big gap, right, in terms of resources out there in the industry. We're all facing it. So how do you repurpose your humans? You repurpose them by having, again, agile macro segmentation, having a system that can actually make decisions on its own to do the mundane day-to-day tasks that your administrators shouldn't have to be doing, right? It frees up cycles on them so that they can solve more complex problems. I will have a couple minutes for some Q&A. I'm going to leave you with this. I don't know if you recognize this image. So this is the Red Queen. I'm talking about the theme of Hive and Swarm. So this is from Resident Evil. We're talking about zombies. But it is another analogy, because if you think of what happened with the Red Queen, she was created as an artificial intelligence solution in the movie. It's fictional work. To be able to be programmed to, A, protect all assets of the umbrella corporation. So think about that hive, the resources, number one priority. And then number two, the safety of human personnel. Of course, what happened in the movie was that she turned against the humans because her number one priority was to protect the assets. There's the T virus that broke out, turned everybody into zombies. But what did she do to defend that? The AI system started shutting doors within the network, trapping people in, quarantining them in order to protect. That's segmentation, right? That's an example of segmentation. I know it's Hollywood and futuristic, but it's just another example of what systems should be capable to do. So turn that mentality into cybersecurity, code, digital assets, data, intellectual property, and so forth. And it's certainly the right step forward. That's right, the White Queen came out after, right? Yeah. So that's the good news. We can do the right thing. Okay, thank you for your time. Do we have a couple of minutes maybe for a Q&A? If I know it's early. Yes? With Hajime or hide and seek? Yeah, there were some similarities with that, for sure, as well. A lot of the strong similarities, and you can, again, we have a lot of details on our blog. We're with, okay, the hide and seek, yeah. Yeah. I mean, source code was leaked years ago, right? And that's the main culprit there, yeah. Yes, sir.
Got a few questions here, so other people have stuff, interrupt me. So a swarm, it seems like one of the advantages is that since it doesn't have central command and control, it wouldn't be vulnerable to a command and control takedown, which is how the big companies love to do it. But it might be vulnerable, since they're all communicating with each other, that if somebody manages to subvert one node and get whatever its keys or certificates were, it could subvert the whole thing. Thoughts?
Yeah, that's a really good point. So that's poisoning, right? Poisoning. So actually, going back to what I talked about with the human mentality, if you're thinking about poisoning the human mind and infectious behavior that happens in a riot, as an example, it's the same kind of thing, right? You have one bad apple, if you will, or bad node, and that can spread throughout the other nodes. And if you're thinking about in terms of takedown or subversion, it could definitely happen that way. I And they're completely vulnerable to that right now. I think in the future, of course, there'll be more authentication put in, right, in terms of ciphers and secure communication between the nodes. We're not seeing that yet. There hasn't been a need for that. On the takedown, absolutely. So keep in mind, peer-to-peer botnets are not new. Conficker is a good example of a peer-to-peer botnet. But and that's been around for the better part of 10 years because it is very tough to take down. You're absolutely right. It's not a centralized command and control. The difference is, those botnets of 10 years ago, a lot of the commands are being issued, it's quite simple, right? The peer-to-peer is just the botnet infrastructure, but it's still centralized in the point of commands coming from the attacker. That's the big evolution we're seeing in IoT right now, is again, nodes communicating commands to each other, right?
Okay. It seems like one thing that could easily happen if it isn't already, is that the swarms would compete with each other for platforms, victims, however you want to phrase it. So
yeah.
Either by hacking the platform and kicking off the one that's there, uh-huh. or simply subverting the agent that's already there to its own. Is this something?
Yeah, and in fact, so I didn't mention that in the analysis, but hide and seek has that capability. So it will actually, when it gets a footprint onto a system or tries to get a footprint, it actually has a module on it called the killer. And the killer module will actually look for processes, like Mirai is one of them, right? So if it sees any competition, if you will, it will actually try to kill those processes and take them over. You can think of it like as, I call it digital real estate, right? Trying to get prime access to that. Yes.
So that is common, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, now here's a hard one. Wouldn't a really intelligent swarm, upon meeting a hive defense, try to subvert the hive defense? A couple examples, start injecting bogus IoTs into it, or causing it to automatically quarantine critical systems.
Yeah, seems like so, yeah, I mean, there's always gonna be an arms race. If you think of even, just going back to malware tries to evade sandbox as an example, right? That's a very simple example. So there's always going to be, we call them AETs, advanced evasion techniques. Swarm will definitely be able to be capable of that. I think, though, you know, when it comes to these swarm networks, it's sort of the wild, wild west. As a black hat attacker, they don't care. They can try to crash systems, processes. They can get a million things wrong. They're not inhibited. For us, we have to get a million things right. That's where artificial intelligence is very important. As an example, we released an AI system this year. We developed it for over 5 years to get it up to a 99.9% accuracy rate and higher, right? So it's anything is possible, but it's how well you train the systems in order to reduce false, you know, in our world, we call it false positives, right? But it's a good point. It's a trust exercise, right?
Hey, how's it going?
Hi.
What are your thoughts on using swarm technology positively instead of negatively, as far as a lot of times people are being vulnerable on the internet due to unpatched systems and poor security controls, and using a positive swarm by, say, the government or by a large organization to go out and purposely help and fix things as opposed to the things it's typically used for?
Yeah, I like the idea. For sure. I mean, mm-hmm. yeah, so I painted the picture of what we're doing in the security space in terms of sharing IOCs and things like that. But in terms, so you're talking about from even like a training or education aspect and trying
well,
to...
Well, even from a technology, just like yep. you just mentioned, some of them, once they get on the system, they prevent the others from getting on. It's
right.
kind of like purposely injecting anti-malware into other systems. Obviously, there's legal issues.
Yeah, I was going to say, there are some, that's the thing in our world, in white hats, there's more roadblocks, so that's one thing we have to overcome. But yeah, I mean, I think there's a lot of positive ways you can use it. I mean, we're just starting to think about this now. I always like to go back to the nature point of view, because there's so many good examples. You think about ants, they've colonized the planet. Why? Because strength in numbers, they're very robust working like that. So there's a lot of biomechanical lessons to be learned that way. But yeah, I think for sure there's a lot of...
Yeah, and on the swarm and, the swarm technologies that you're currently talking about, like you mentioned, where they might poison the well, are you seeing any kind of self-defending eradication of outside influence? Like you just mentioned with the ants, one ant gets hurt, maybe they take them out, the rest of them do.
Yeah,
are you seeing that at all?
Not yet, no. Like I said, I think as these evolve, we'll see that. We'll see more, again, authentication, so you can't just Again, someone can try to subvert the network by issuing an unauthenticated command, as an example. Yeah. Okay. But thanks. We'll start to see that, I think. Okay. Okay. Yep. Thank you. Thank you for your time.